it's all alone. Now the malt's come down.
Malt's come down, malt's come down, from an old angel to a French crown.
The gentleman leaves his porter brown and drinks with his plough boy. The malt's come down.
Malt's come down, malt's come down, from an old angel to a French crown. And many the clergyman worried his frown. There's none to the mass now, the malt's come down.
Malt's come down, malt's come down, from an old angel to a French crown.
King Jamie, he hath made a vow, and keep it well if he may, that he will be in merry London upon St. James's Day. Upon St. James's Day at noon in London will I be, and all the lords in merry Scotland there shall dine with me. And up then spake Queen Margaret, and the tears fell from her eye. Leave off these wars, most noble king, and keep your fidelity. For the water runs swift and wondrous deep, from the bottom and to the brim. And me brother Henry has men good enough. England is hard to win. Away! Away with this silly fool in prison, must let her lie, for she has come of the English blood. For these words she shall die. And up then spake Lord Thomas Howard, the Queen's Chamberlain that day, if you put Queen Margaret to death, Scotland shall rue it always. Then in a rage King James did say, away this foolish mole, he shall be hanged, the other be burned, as soon as I come home at Bloodenfield. The Scots came in, which made our Englishmen vain, and at Bramston Green this battle was seen, and there was Jamie slain. Well, presently the Scots did fly, their cannons they left behind, their ensigns gay were won all the way, for a soldier's beat the blind to tell your plain 12,000 were slain. That the fight did stand, and many prisoners took that day the best in all Scotland.
This day left many a fatherless child, and many a widow poor, and many a Scottish gay lady sat weeping in her bower.
Jack with a feather was lapped, all in leather, his boasting was all in vain. Well, he had such a chance with a new Morris dance, and he never came home again.
Jamie, he has made a vow, and keep it well if he may, that he will be in merry London on St. James's
good sir, then did she say, what do I care? For I will, without fail, maiden, give you Watkins ale. Watkins ale, good sir, quoth she, what is that, I pray tell me? Tis sweeter far than sugar pine, and pleasanter than muscadine. And if you please, fair maid, to stay a little while with me to play, I will give you the same Watkins ale bought by name, or else I were to blame. In truth, fair maid, good sir, quoth she again, if you will take the pain, I will it not refrain nor be dismayed. He took this maiden then aside, and led her where she was not spied, and told her many a pretty tale, and gave her well of Watkins ale. When he had done to her his will, they taught but what it shall not skill. At last, quoth she, saving your tale, pray give me more of Watkins ale, or else I will not stay, for I must needs away. My mother bade me play, the time is past. Therefore, good sir, quoth she, if you have done with me, nay, stop, fair maid, quoth he again at last. Let us talk a little while. And then the maid began to smile, and she said, good sir, full well I know, your ale, I see, runs very low.
Thank you.
sick, her maidenhead began to kick. Her colour waxed wan and pale from taking much of Watkin's ale. I wish all maidens coy that hear this pretty toy, wherein most women joy how they do sport. For surely Watkin's ale, and if it be not stale, will turn them to some bale, as has report. Good ale will make their bellies bone, as trials by this babe is known. This proverb has been taught in schools, it is no jesting with hedged tools.
In court and bay lying, with the blue beams flying, and all hands on deck, the anchor's away. As fresh as a daisy, and modestly hailing, our captain did say, "Ship boy, lend a hand there, I want a young man there, so heave us some adrope, or send him to me. His name's Henry Grady, and I am the lady, desired to prevent him from going to sea." When he looked upon her, he ran down the side for to hand her on board. Said he with emotion, "What son of the ocean can thus be looked after by Helen aboard?" Then the lady made answer, "But there is the master, I'll make him as free as a duke or a lord." "Oh no," said the captain, "that can very well happen. You've got sailing orders, you sir, stop on board." Then up spoke the lady, "Don't you mind him, Hal Brady. He once was your captain, but now you're at large. You shan't stop on board, for all that chap's order. Then now from her bosom she pulled his discharge." Said the captain, "I'm dang now, you tool, and I'm bang now. So now, hero with a face, take all your clothes and ashore." Then he steered her, and his best mates all cheered her, but the captain was jealous, could look down his mouth. And she got a short tailor fix up a sailor in white nankeen trousers and a long blue tailed coat, and he looked like a squire for all to admire, with a dimity handkerchief tied round his throat. They'd a house that was greater than any first rater, with footmen in livery handing the drink, and a garden to go in where all things was growing, the buttercup, the daisy, the lily and the pink. And he got education befitting his station, for all of us know that we're not too old to learn. And his best mates, they found him with the little ones all around him, all chips of the old block from the stem to the stern. So all ye that have notions to sail across the ocean, make sure that your voyaging will do you no harm. And you, Captain Shady, to find a rich lady, and she'll give you safe home far from tempest and from storm.
Thank you. he saved a chain short. And when he was wounded, to his merry men he did say, "Take me up in your arms, boys, and carry me away." All the guns they did rattle, and the bullets did fly, but Admiral Benbow for help would not cry. "Take me down to the cockpit, there is ease for my smarts. If my merry men see me, it will sure break their hearts." And the very next morning, by the break of the day, they hoisted their topsails and they so bore away. We bore to Port Royal, Admiral Benbow carried to Kingston Church. So come all you brave fellows, wherever you've been, let us ring to the help of our King and our Queen. And another good help to the girls that we know, and a third in remembrance of Admiral Benbow.
What talker can prognosticate concerning kings or kingdom's fate? I think myself to be as wise as he that gazeth on the skies. My skill goes beyond the depths of a pond or rivers in the greatest rain, whereby I can tell that all things will be well when the King enjoys his own again. Though for a time we see Whitehall with cobwebs hanging on the wall,
I have been all day looking after a raven feeding on a quarter. And soon as she turned her beak to the south, I plucked this morsel out of her mouth. I have been gathering of wolves' hairs, the mad dog's bones, and the adder's ears. The spurging of a dead man's eyes and all since evening started rise. I last night lay all alone upon the ground to hear the mandrake groan, and plucked him up, though he grew full lone, as I had done the cock did crow. And I have been choosing out this skull from charnel houses that were full, from private grots and public pits, and frightened the sexton out of his wits. Under a cradle, swiftly I did creep, and when the child was asleep, 'twas then I sucked the breath, and rose and plucked the nodding nurse by the nose. I had a dagger, what did I with that? I killed an infant for to have its fat. A piper got in an ancient tale, I fed him again, blow the wind in a tail. A murderer yonder, he was hanged in chains, the sand in the wind so shrunk his veins. I bit him a sinew, I clipped his hair, I tore up his bags and danced in the air. I went to the tomb, the trees under the wall. I charmed him out, and he came at my call. I scratched out the eyes of the owl before, and saw the bat's wing. The screech owl's legs and the feathers black, the blood of the frog and the bone in his back. These I have been getting and made of his skin, a person to keep Sir Stallion in. And I have been plucking plants among hemlock and vine and the adder's tongue. Nightshade, moonwort and limpet vein, and twice by the dog replied to be slain. Yes, I have brought to help you with your vows, corn and poppy and the cyber.
the dangers of the ocean. One morning in the month of June, the feathered warbling songsters, their charming notes so sweet did tune.
Took 300,000 men, and likewise kings for to join his throng. He was so well provided, enough to sweep this world along.
Is the hearts of oak. England, Ireland, and Scotland, their unity has ne'er been broke. And son, to your father, in St. Helena, his body lies low.
The sands and lofty rocks.
weary spot, whereupon our gallant hero his heavy eyes did close, and while his precious bones do rot, his memory ne'er shall be forgot. This grand conversation on Napoleon arose. Oh, England, why did you presume to persecute this hero bold? Far better had you slain him on the plains of Waterloo. Napoleon, he was a friend to heroes brave, both young and old. He made the money for to fly wherever he did go. Plans were arranging day and night, this bold commander to betray. He says, I'll conquer Moscow, and that will ease my woe. If fortune shine on me today, all men on earth shall me obey. This grand conversation on Napoleon arose. So hundreds and thousands he did then arise to conquer Moscow by surprise. He led his men across the Alps, oppressed by frost and snow. But drawing near to Russian lands, he then began to open his eyes. All Moscow was ablazing, and his men drove to and fro. Napoleon, dauntless, fueled the flames and wept in anguish for the same. He cries, retreat by gallant lads, for time does swiftly go. Died in the retreat somewhere.
Born
manage your credit advance is tough to be won by venturing your life. So you leave at home a good friend by your wife. Werehogs. As soon as you come to your enemy's land, where fat goose and capon are at your command, sing, take them and eat them, sing, leave.